Thank you for such a good welcome. Hallelujah. So I'm doubly blessed. Unexpectedly, I got to preach two times. So, but there is no coincidence in the word in Hebrew language. So it is divine appointment. Hallelujah. What an awesome worship. How many of you feel the presence of the Lord? Hallelujah. I believe we are living in such an exciting time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I believe there is great things ahead of us. Hallelujah. Do you believe that? This is harvest time. God's going to use every one of us. He wants to use all of us. Hallelujah. God is going to do great things through you. He's going to release miracles through your hands. Do you believe that? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There are many things that come to my mind. I like to talk about changing our mindset. Dealing with your demon. By that I mean dealing with your weaknesses in your life. Hallelujah. We know that promotion is coming. The time that Joel prophesied in Joel chapter 2 is upon us today. The Lord said, in the last day, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and daughters will prophesy. Old men will dream dreams, and young men will have vision. God is going to release his awesome power in the heaven and on earth so that people will know that there is no God like Jehovah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We are living in that time. Many a time we think, oh, when I'm more mature, when I graduate from college, God's going to use me. Or we think, if I finish one more degree, God's going to use me. No, God wants to use you now. Amen. You are even equipped right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. So, like the word of God for us this year is that the year of exalting, exaltation. God's going to exalt you. He's going to lift you up. He's going to promote you. How many of you believe that? Amen. Amen. Thank you. So, in order to advance, there are times God allow us to deal with old mindsets. I like to call them our demons. You know what your weakness is, right? Last year, I was seeking the Lord at IHOP. Even though I was so busy reading because I couldn't really find, the right design for my research. So I decided to spend time with God instead of studying. I went away like 5 days. At that time, the Lord spoke to me. I did not know about the year of exalting, okay? But the Lord said something. He's getting me ready for something big in the year ahead. And then the Lord also showed me that if I don't deal with my demon now, that's going to cause me a lot of trouble. And then I asked the Lord, Lord, show me the holes in my armor. We know that as soldiers for Jesus Christ, we are well dressed with the whole armor of God. I know you have all the armor, like the breastplate of righteousness. You're righteous in Jesus. We have the belt of truth. We have the helmet of salvation, readiness and preparedness to share the gospel, which is a shoe, and all these things. But still, when we don't deal with our tiny, small weaknesses, which are okay in peacetime, but when you actually go into war, they're going to cause your downfall. For example, Goliath, he was fully covered all over. There was only one spot around here, maybe also the eyes, I guess. So David just shot that spot, right? So that's what the Lord gave me. That was the thought. So I asked the Lord, Lord, you got to show me more clearly. I know I can tell many, many weaknesses. We can do that, right? When they ask you to repent, and we can think about all the things you committed like 40 years ago, 20 years ago, 40 years ago is for me, okay, not for you. So you count back and say, we know we're very good at that. But I'm not talking about that. Ask the Lord to specifically reveal what the demon that you have to deal with. Amen? So I like to talk about that. And also, I like to talk about our identity. So, like I said, I'm going to jump from one thought to another because I truly believe God is getting us ready for something big. Amen? Do you believe that? Turn to your neighbor and say, something great is waiting you. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Many times we believe, we think that, oh, like I said, I'm not ready yet. We keep on postponing the time, God's Kairos moment for our life. In fact, if we believe in the word of the Lord, this is our Kairos moment now. The Bible says faith is now. Amen. Do you believe that? When you believe, all the promises that are in the future come alive to you right now. That's what faith is. We don't need, the Bible says, in order to get the answer, there is no need for anyone to go up to heaven to bring down Jesus so that we can see the manifestation of the promise. It's in Romans, I believe, chapter 10, 11, 4, whoever knows, it, tell me. So in Romans. Or there is no need for anybody to send someone to go down to bring back Jesus. The Lord said, the word is near you. It is in your mouth. By that, God is saying, all that we need are made available already in the written word of God. When we believe that and confess it, the miracle begins now. Amen? Amen. So God is going to use you now. Amen? I really want you to believe. Right now, we sing a lot about harvest, like revival in the city, revival in our life, revival in our church. Don't wait like in Jerusalem. The people, before the Holy Spirit was sent down, they have to wait for 10 days fasting and prayer. But the Holy Spirit has already been poured out on his people. We don't have to tarry and wait in Jerusalem anymore. Hallelujah. I want you to step into your future now by faith. Amen. So whenever God gave us an open door, and whenever, this is my experience, whenever God spoke a word of revelation to me, the first thing I face is challenges, blockage. Because it's a pattern in the Bible. Whenever God says, I give you this land, you met the giant. Unless you take down that giant, you don't inherit that land. Or whenever God says, I make an open door before you, there are many adversities. That's what Paul said. He went to Corinthians. He went to this idolatrous city. There was so much sin in that city. It looks like impossible to take down that city. Like what you would call New York or Los Angeles. They're so corrupt. They're so immoral. To the point that when people want to say someone is so corrupt in his, like, immoral and corrupt, they will say it's Corinthians. That's what they call in those days. So for Paul, the chances of winning that city were so small. To see a revival in Corinth was so small. As he was seeking the Lord, I believe he started sharing. Nobody wanted to listen. So he may feel like, Lord, what should I do now? I don't know. They don't explain everything. But at night, the Lord said, don't worry. I have many people in this city. I am with you. Preach. And then God said, I have an open door for you. That's why when Paul wrote about that, God placed an open door before me, but there are also many adversaries. So in order to take down the adversity, God has already given you the power of the Holy Spirit. With the power of the Holy Spirit, you mix that with faith, word of faith in your mouth, you can take down the giants. Amen? But the thing is, that's the easy part. The thing is, if we don't deal with the weaknesses or the holes in our armor, even though we may go into possess, that's going to cause us to trip over. That's what happened to Israel. They possess the land. They don't deal with sin issue in their life. They don't deal with these weaknesses, personal weaknesses. They think that conquering the outward enemy is a greater job. They neglect the inward enemy that caused their downfall. Amen? So I'd like to talk about that as well. So I don't know how to begin, but let me tell you. There are demons attached to us. When I say that, she's talking about like we are having demons. We talk about deliverance ministry already. We know that Christians can have demon influence, but we're not possessed. By that I mean, like demons, they cannot read our thoughts, but they are called familiar spirit. By watching our lives, by watching what we speak, how we react to different situations, he can read our personality. What can make us angry? What can make us happy? What is our weakness? He knows. He used those information accordingly to trap us and to cause our downfall. So I would like to call them familiar spirit. Many a time when we say, hey, God's going to exalt you. One day you're going to own a business company. You will become a CEO. When we say those big things, I believe there are a lot of hypocrisy in the church of God. When we say, yeah, we say amen, but we don't truly believe that. We don't truly dare to step out in that. We keep on waiting for so many years, postponing the fruit of that promise. I like to say that the time has come upon us now. Amen? Amen? If you truly believe that, you can start walking in that already. But those demons will say, no, it cannot happen. Who do you think you are? Remember your parents. They are peasant in Chin State. They're so very poor. They only have corn and beans. They don't even have meat every day, every meal. Don't dream about that. They're not talking about you. It's about someone else. You know, the demon started talking to you. Unless you rebuke that demon and say, you are a liar. I am a child of God. I believe in the word of the Lord. I'm going to walk in that. Unless you do that, the demon's trying to steal away your future. So today I'd like to challenge you. Starting from today, believe that you are one of the end time harvester. Hallelujah. Believe that God is going to use me. Just you. When you speak, people will be blessed. Hallelujah. People will be saved. They will respect the anointing that is upon your life. You may be the lowest worker in your company, but because of the anointing and the glory of God that you carry, they will respect that anointing and they will listen to your word. Hallelujah. Believe that when you pray for the sick, they are going to be healed. Hallelujah. When you started believing that, don't worry about the level of anointing. You're going to start to see the result. That's what happened to me. Sometimes when I'm in church, a lot of people, like when they come up for prayer, I do pray by faith. But I have more chance of seeing people get healed the moment I pray for them when I travel. Do you know why? I expect more. Lord, you got to do it now. Like, I challenge them. I give them the word of faith. I believe that will happen now. And then I tell them to receive it now. So I see miracle many times when I travel. But when I'm in here, sometimes I think, we're so familiar with each other. You know, I'm not a traveling evangelist. So I also reduce my level of expectancy. The anointing is the same on me, okay? The audience is, they have the same faith level. Let's say they all believe in healing. I mean, theologically, we are at the same field. But still, the level of manifestation we see different based on our expectation. So I like you to change your mindset. Amen? See, I'm a child of God. I have the Holy Spirit. I have the anointing of God. I am anointed and the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. When I speak, people will be healed. People will get saved. People will get comforted. They will receive wisdom and direction from God. Hallelujah. When I believe that, there are times when people approach me to pray for them. I said, Lord, I really want to give them a word. When I wish that, the Lord always give me. Just recently, just a week ago or 10 days ago, I prayed for one lady for direction. She was so distressed about what she's going through. She has challenges. Usually they will say, like, when you prophesy, don't give them direction. But I feel so badly to say something and for her to change direction, take another route. I simply said that because we know each other so well. Even if I miss it, I know I'm sure that's the case. So I just tell her, hey, I think you should stop pursuing this and do something else. So I received confirmation a week later. That's what the Lord has been speaking to her. And also someone near her family also said the same thing. What I'm saying is, don't worry so much about like gathering in, you know, like more anointing, like you are charging the battery. How many percent is for like 70%, 80%? When my phone battery is 100%, I'm going to start to function. Do you ever do that? When you need it, when you're on the go, you just take off from the charger. It was only 40%. It can still function, isn't it? So I'm not talking about don't worry about the increase of anointing. I believe you guys already are anointed. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. The only thing needed is to activate the gift that is in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So deal with the demon. And the demon say, oh no, you will never be like that. Because like we are habitual people. When we see our teachers, our leaders do, we do it the same. We cannot think farther than that. Sometimes we think that it like our pastor is a pastor of 6,000 church member. If you say, I want to have 1 million member, we feel like we're arrogant. It is not arrogant. If you're more successful than your parents, it's not dishonoring them. You are honoring them. Amen? Amen? Like my father used to say, when we were smaller, I couldn't understand that. He said, my children, he said, you are supposed to be greater than I am. You have to achieve more than I do. When my dad said, it's so difficult to believe because, like, he is a doctor, he is high government official in our nation. A lot of people respect him. We were just high school kids. I thought, how can we be greater than our dad? We cannot believe that. But my dad also said that every generation must become better and must be able to accomplish more. If not, that family line or that nation will go down. They will decline. When I grow older, I understand that. If you achieve more than I do, I believe that I am a success. Hallelujah. If one of my convert or one of my disciples win 100 million souls, I believe I am a success. Hallelujah. So don't just confine your horizon or don't define your vision based on what your leaders has done, based on your parents' condition. The demon will say, oh, nobody in your family has ever done this. Nobody in your family is called to the ministry. Don't even try. You can just tell him, the devil, you are a liar. I believe in the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And also I see among our people, we have this, even in Myanmar, tribal people, like Chin people, we have this inferiority complex. That's what I see. Like, you cannot speak like them. You cannot speak Burmese or you feel ashamed. Even you may be very knowledgeable in something, but you are so afraid to speak up. I will say that time is over. Amen. It's time to deal with that inferiority as well. Now you all come to America. We just thought, oh, I cannot speak English like they do. Who cares? You are equally a child of God. Amen. I'm not saying not to learn the language. Just because you cannot speak their language like they do, it doesn't make you stupid. It doesn't make you inferior. Amen. You can walk tall. Amen. When you have that confidence, when you know your true identity, all your ability will surface and you can bear fruit. Many a time, because of inferiority, even though you have the same ability, you function lower than your capacity. If you want to function to your full capacity, you have to deal with the demon of inferiority. Can you say amen? 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 I really thank my dad. My dad usually said when we were young, he said, you know, the white people, the American, the English, they're kind of lazy. They are not industrious and studying. That's what my dad said. He said, if you guys were in the same school, I believe my kids, you will score higher than them. That's what my dad usually said. So I never look up on these people. I'm not saying I look down on them. Since I was a child, I've never been to abroad, but I already have this mentality. We are equal. I never feel inferior when we talk about like foreigners. So in my early 20s, I started working for God's anointed ministers across the world. I never feel ashamed interpreting for them. I don't mean I'm arrogant. I thank the Lord for my dad. He prepared our hearts. I never felt inferior. I'm coming cool. If I make mistake, I make mistake. I'm fine. I'm doing my best for God. So that really sets me free. Had I had this inferiority, I would be shaking knees and, you know, even if I know the word, because of fear, I will forget it or I will not say it correctly. Do you get my point? So from now on, when the demon of inferiority come knocking on your door, tell him, I don't open the door to you. You don't belong here. You are a liar. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. Is it good? Okay, so I'd like to read some scripture that the Lord gave me, two scripture. First, in Joshua chapter 3. Joshua chapter 3, verses 4 and 5. Yet there shall be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Do not come near it, that you may know the way by which you must go, for you have not passed this way before. I'd like you to notice, this is about the time they were about to cross the Jordan. They were about to enter their promised land. So the word of the Lord say, you have not gone to this way before. Like I said, I truly believe there is great things in store for you. Right in 2019. Don't think about 5 years later. Don't think about 10 years later. This is the time, the favorable time of the Lord. This is the year, the day that the Lord's going to answer your prayer. This is the day the Lord's going to bless you and prosper you and promote you. Amen? So don't think. But the Bible says, you have not gone this way before. And then it goes on to say, in verse 5, Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourself, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. Hallelujah. Sanctify yourself because tomorrow the Lord's going to do wonders among you. Talking about you dealing with your demon, your weaknesses, all the old mindsets that hinder you from seeing God's hand move on your behalf. Amen. I'd like to also give you another scripture. Judges chapter 4, verse 14. Judges chapter 4, verse 14. Then Deborah said to Barak, up, for this is the day in which the Lord has delivered Sisera into your hand. Has not the Lord gone out before you? Hallelujah. I really like it. This is prophetic. Prophet Deborah said to the general, up means rise up now. Amen? The Lord is telling you to rise up now. Take your position. Ready. That's what she is saying because he is about to win mighty battle. Amen? And then it says, this is the time. This is the day in which the Lord has delivered Sisera into your hand. Has not the Lord gone before you? If you decided to deal with your giants, the Lord is saying, this is the day. I deliver that giant, that demon into your hand. Hallelujah. I have already gone before you. Can you say amen? Do you believe that? Let's confess that it's time to deal with the giants. It's time to deal with my demons. Amen. Hallelujah. So it says the Lord has already gone out before you. You may be thinking, oh no, I'm struggling with this weakness for many years. I think it would take more years of receiving the word, prayer, in order to get delivered. No. When you believe, faith is now. The moment you receive that word, its power is broken off you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I am declaring victory over my life as well. Hallelujah. I am declaring that I'm not going to see this giant anymore. Hallelujah. I'm going to walk in greater freedom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So that this weakness or this demon cannot hinder my progress. So the Bible is saying here, get ready. Today, the Lord's going to give you the demon, your demon that is bothering into your hand. Today is your day of freedom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I'd like to also encourage you about the way you see yourself. Many times, I already said it a lot of times, if we don't truly walk in our identity, if we don't truly embrace our identity, even though we hear the word preach, we hear the word say, like, I give you power and authority over all demons, nothing can by any means harm you, I give you power and authority. We believe that. We say, I have the mind of Christ, I can do all things through Christ. We memorize all this scripture, but we operate in the same way. When we face one of our weaknesses, when we face some challenge, we are still defeated again and again. I believe that time should stop now. Amen? But if we truly know our identity, believing in the promises of God is so easy. If we don't believe in your identity, in one way, even though you believe the word of God, you cannot really have this full assurance to function in that. I really like what one preacher talked about. How to understand our identity. I'd like to share that again to you. It said, When you think about your value and worth, how what you can do, you can always ask your maker. Like when they manufacture car, when you register your car, they ask you what make, what year, what model, right? And then when the car manufacturer, after they manufacture the car or the like Whirlpool, what's that, refrigerator, aircon, whatever it is, it comes with a manual and the manufacturer guide. It will explain what the product is, what it can do, and all the functions of that thing. And then they give them, like, say, 1 year guarantee or 2 year guarantee. You buy a new brand new car, zero mileage, or refrigerator, or whatever it is. If you started using it, you see that this thing doesn't really function well. There are some flaws here. And, you know, when you feel like that, you can always send that thing back to the manufacturer. They're going to replace it with something else, and they're going to give it to you. So, this is what he said. If you see yourself, I'm not that good, when comparing with others, who asked us to compare ourselves with others? That's the greatest downfall, right? We like to compare us with others. You know, when we compare with others, I'm not good enough. I wish I'm taller. I wish I'm shorter. I wish I'm fairer. I wish I have a longer nose, shorter nose. I don't know. We are so picky. I wish I can speak more. I cannot sing. I wish I'm a musician. So we always wish for something that we don't have. God did not give us that because we don't need that. Amen. We have great musicians to sing and play. You don't need to worry about going here on time, practicing, going through all the hard work. You can just enjoy their music and worship God. How good is that? Hallelujah. So when we can value and appreciate others' gift, it's not about, I want to be better than them. No, we're all one family. Your beauty and your gift complement me and make me look better. If you are shining with God's glory, that light also reflect on me. I got blessed by that too. If we know that, we're going to celebrate our differences and our gifting. Amen? So we like to compare and complain. So this is what you have to do. Send yourself back to your maker, the manufacturer. Lord, why do you make me? What am I here for? I'm not, you know, I go to work, I have problem with people. I go to school, I have problem with people. Lord, you need to fix me back. Amen. You send yourself back to the manufacturer. He's going to fix you so that you can function perfectly in your role. If you don't know your identity and your role, ask your maker. Amen. When you know your value, when you know your maker is in his intention, his purpose for creating you, you will be so free to be who you are. Amen? Amen. Many a time we also like to put a value on ourselves. We calculate how worth you are. Like in the world, they have, based on their wealth, we say his value is 4 million, 20 million, based on what they have. But our value is not supposed to be calculated that way. We're as valuable as God created us. When people sell product, this is how they also make the price. If the buyer want to pay more, the product will have more value. If the buyer say, oh, we don't like gold. Gold is not used. It's just shining. I cannot eat. We don't like gold. Then the value will go down. If you want something, if more people is willing to pay more for one thing, one product, the value goes up. So if you want to know your value, ask the Lord how much he is willing to pay for you to buy you back. Amen? God gave us his one and only son to buy us back to him. You are as valuable as the blood of Jesus. You are as valuable as Jesus Christ to God. Amen? When you truly know that and let that sink into your heart, you will be so feel free. You will feel your worth in God. Amen? Your education doesn't matter. How much you own in a bank doesn't matter. How much you have in things doesn't matter. We are all equally valuable in the sight of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When we know that, we are going to be free to function in how God calls us to be. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So this is my message. So it's time to deal with our demons. I believe I'm going to hear testimonies from you guys. about sharing the word to someone and they get helped, or praying for the sick and they got healed. Are you going to do that? Amen. The time is now. Say, the time is now. Hallelujah. God is going to use me. Say, lift up your hands. Say, these hands are healing hands. God's healing power will flow through my hands. Demons will tremble and flee when I command them to live in Jesus' name. Through these hands, God is going to release miracles. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's shout to the Lord and give thanks. Let's end with one praising song. I'd like to sing about the harvest. Harvest around the world. Let's sing, "This is the day of Elijah." God is getting ready his church so that we are prepared for the greatest harvest of souls. We're about to see it starting from today. Hallelujah. There will be more people coming into our church as well. There will be more people in your youth group. Hallelujah. You'll start to see miracles through your hand. Financial miracle, healing miracle, relationship reconciliation. Hallelujah. Let's sing it by faith and let's celebrate before the Lord.
Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call. Lift your voice at the year of Jubilee. Days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sorrow. Still we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Hey! Oh, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Rebuilding the temple of praise. Oh, these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Let the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Oh, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Let the trumpet call, lift your voice, it's year of Jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Jehovah. There's no God like 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 Jehovah. Oh, He comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Let the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion soon salvation comes. Behold, He comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Let the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion soon salvation comes. Oh, He comes riding on the clouds, hey!
Shining like the sun,
hey!
And the trumpet calls,
lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion soon salvation comes. Oh, He comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun.
You are going to operate in a greater level of anointing.
Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord. We're going to see testimonies. We're going to hear testimonies from now on. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Father God, thank you for what you have done in our midst. Through the blood of Jesus, with the righteousness that you gave us, Lord, we thank you that we overcome by your blood, by the blood of the Lamb. Thank you for helping us in our weaknesses. Lord, we thank you for your power that war against our enemy on behalf of us when we look to you, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you that our demons and our weaknesses have been dealt with, and we're going to walk in a greater freedom. We're going to see miracles flow in our lives. Father, we're going to see your favor going, making way before us, and opening unexpected doors, Father. We bless you. We welcome all the young people that you're bringing into our church. We welcome all the people who are backsliding that you're bringing to our church. Use us all, Lord. Here we are. Send us, O Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We give you all the glory for what you have done in our midst tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah.
Thank you, praise and worship.